Tuatahi, kia koe dini, whakatūne te alawhata ki te wāhi ngaro. Tēnā koe. Kei te mana whenua, kei te mana tangata. Kei te mauri whenua, kei te mauri tangata. Koutou kua mihia e ngā kaikoro mua atu iau. E tautoko noe hoana i ngā mihi kia koutou. Ko te whakaaro, ko mātou kua rangatira iau koutou i te pōne. Tō reira huri, huri. Ki te iwi takata whenua, tēnā koutou. Ki te kai whakahaere, ki te rangatira o te whare taonga, o te iwi taketake o tēnei whenua, tēnā hoki koe, nau nei wāhi ngā mihi, kia mātou. I have prefaced the remarks I'm about to make with a ngiri, a rhythmic recited chant composed in May 2011 and inspired by comments made by Dr. Wharehuia Milroy at a graduation ceremony of students of Te Panikiratanga o Te Reo, the Institute of Excellence in the Māori language, and it translates as follows. Dr. Milroy has issued the dictum, return the language to its rightful position, from the tip of the pen to the tip of the tongue, lest it remain a language destined solely for pen and paper, rather than finding its niche in the hearts and soul of us all. If a plant lies dormant in the ground, it will never effloresce or reach full bloom. If planted, however, in fertile soil, in the heart of those who care, how could the growth not be vigorous or luxuriant, and your bouquet savoured, O my language, by all your people throughout the South and North Islands of New Zealand? What can accrue from forever pointing the finger of blame? Absolutely nothing. But what will aspiration and determination achieve? An inordinate amount. Let us, like the oyster catcher, avail ourselves of every opportunity offered and enjoy the feast, for tomorrow there could well be a famine. Ours then is to ensure that the years to come will be nothing but years of plenty. With those sentiments, O my language, return to where you should be, to my bosom, to my heart, to my tongue, to my total being, where you will live on into the millennia to come. The following slides include keywords in Te Reo Māori with their English translation that I will use during this address. As many Indigenous peoples of the world mourn the decline in the number of native speakers of their languages, it seems timely to take a critical look at our situations as they are, rather than as we would wish them to be. Of course, if wishes were horses, then beggars would certainly ride. But as my culture would have it, he koura, he manako te koura I kore ai. While the proverb is culturally pragmatic, its extended meaning is that nothing comes from nothing. It seems ironic that one of the simplest means of language transmission should revolutionize the world of Indigenous people seeking to revive, retain, and maintain their languages that are threatened. And here I make reference to Kohanga Reo and its philosophy of the child taking the language along with its mother's milk. In its very simplicity, layered success, since it is a universal philosophy, and yet for some reason, Indigenous peoples abandoned the idea with regard to their own languages and replaced it with the language of the colonizer, thereby very much ensuring that that language in particular would be the one in which the tribe would become most proficient and fluent, and yet very inept in its own. What is interesting about the Kohanga Reo philosophy is that it emanated from the elders, the native-speaking generation of the time, as a buffer against the decline in the number of speakers. It was they who voluntarily manned all the Kohanga Reo around the country at the outset, thereby exposing children of that very fortunate generation to the language of the native speaker. Such initiatives as Kohanga Reo are normally the prerogative of the educated middle class, but such was not the case with Kohanga Reo. The philosophy of Kohanga Reo is one of total immersion with the concentration on a high oral command and a minimal regard for literacy and numeracy. It is the time when the child is most receptive to pronunciation, rhythm, nuances, subtleties, and registers of language that become increasingly elusive and virtually impossible to master if one begins one's language journey at an older age and is not exposed to exemplars who are masters of the language. Since such is the case, it would seem patently obvious that it is crucial and therefore axiomatic that the exemplars at this most elementary stage should have an exceedingly good command of the language. As the language acquisition process increases, so does the imperative for very good exemplars. In the situation where the number of native speakers or speakers with high-level fluency are very much in the decline, what is the destiny of those who want their children to learn the language? Some are of the opinion that a little is better than none at all, no matter how indifferent or inaccurate that little might be. It is not a philosophy that I subscribe to, as I see no point in exposing people to blatantly incorrect usage, which someone else has to correct at a later stage in the language acquisition process. It does nothing for the mana, the ethos of the language, or for the mana, the reputation, of the person feeding that level of language to the student. Really, is a smattering of incorrect language to be preferred to no language at all? That is the question for the contemporary parent of students of Maori language or any other language to consider seriously. While being labelled a language purist, even a language Hitler on occasion, I, language philistine that I am considered to be, in the eyes of some, hasten to add that I realise full well that all languages change over time. As a friend of mine, Dr. Terry Crowley, states in his book, An Introduction to Historical Linguistics, and I quote, "Up till now, I have stressed the fact that language change is natural. If we speakers of our languages let things take their natural course, our language will inevitably change in one way or another, given sufficient time." He goes on, quote, "Even the most ferocious teachers in schools with the most fearsome whips cannot turn time back as far as language change is concerned." I think these not so subtle remarks might have been a dig at me. Language change, by my definition, is the adoption of structures that are foreign to the language concerned, although the words being employed in the structure are of the language. Consequently, if no fearsome whip is cracked on occasion, that language can become an unmitigated amalgam of words of sound and fury signifying nothing, at least to the native or competent speaker of the language concerned. The perpetrator of the abomination may well think that his or her linguistic command puts him or her in the genius category, but they are none more deluded than the ignorant. The central grammar of the language needs to be maintained, say I, despite the barrage from the incompetent and those whose command leaves much to be desired. The borrowing of terms and expressions from another language are a valid language development, as is the very essential coining of new terms. In this regard, Maori has changed over recent years as a more conservative element dictates how the language should develop, but that seems to meet the approval of the Maori-speaking minority. I have no problem with this particular practice, since I was very much guilty of it when I was appointed the inaugural Maori Language Commission in 1987 and holding that position until 2002. Upon initial contact with Pākehā, the European culture, and the inevitable high level of intermarriage that it resulted, many words were borrowed freely from what was to become the dominant language and culture. As a matter of interest, many Maori words and phrases have been incorporated into standard New Zealand English, so the borrowing process has not been entirely one way. I would like to take up the cudgel against statements made by my dear departed friend, Dr. Terry Crowley, for his unjust maligning of us in his book, An Introduction to Historical Linguistics. He states, and I quote, "However, Te Tauawhiritere o Māori," that's the Māori Language Commission, "felt that it was important for the Māori language to be protected from the overpowering influence of English as a way of ensuring the independence of the threatened Māori language, and there has been a tendency to avoid words of English origin," unquote. He's got his wires crossed there, but that's all right. What became the policy of the Māori Language Commission, along with my very active and unashamed encouragement, was what is referred to as broadening by linguists. That is, extending the meaning of a particular word as long as its original meaning approximated that of the new term being coined or sounded like the new word term being sought. Let me exemplify. Pukapuka, meaning lungs, was later coined for book because it sounds like book. Huka, meaning snow, is also used to mean sugar because it sounds like sugar, and so the list goes on. As a consequence of this broadening philosophy, many words extant in the language but long unused, particularly as generations of fluent speakers who would have employed those words passed on. We're revived, dusted off, and exposed to the light of a new day, thereby giving life once more to said words, as well as adding further definitions where appropriate. The criticism was immediately levelled by some of the fluent speakers that a new Maori language was being manufactured and created with words comprehensible only to those responsible for the manufacturing and the creating. Despite these negative reactions, the terms are being actively employed by second language learners and among many more enlightened native speakers, aided and abetted by Maori language television, which uses the terms freely and thereby gives them wider currency. Te Panikiretanga o Te Reo, a course set up principally for the really fluent second language learner under the aegis of Te Wānanga o Aotearoa, a Maori tertiary institution, has also been tarred with the same brush. It has been accused of employing what some refer to as arcane, archaic, incomprehensible terms. However, like the duck, it is water off our backs, as many of the words have merely been revived and are to be found in classical chants and haka. In much of the writings of generations past, who were prolific writers to Maori language publications of their time, to government about all kinds of issues, as well as to each other. Quite often, heated debates ensued through the columns of Maori language newspapers over matters of protocol, ritual, and traditional knowledge, providing contemporary generations with examples of language at its most literary and at its most colloquial. The conventions employed were often those of formal oratory on the marae. When the Maori Language Commission was first set up, there was a high demand from the teachers in total immersion schools who wanted terms for all sorts of situations pertinent to school. Terms employed at present by the education system were coined by us of the Maori Language Commission and have been adopted so widely that many think they are words that have been in existence for some considerable time. The initial 3 years that the Commission was in existence were devoted to the coining of new terms, but now a number of Maori organisations are coining their own terms, leading to a veritable plethora, many of which are unintelligible and incomprehensible, and whose provenance remains a mystery. Some would perhaps consider the coining of new terms to be a mark of healthy language development and resilience. English has shamelessly borrowed from all the languages of the world and has become the rich language that it is as a consequence. Can that be said of the Maori language? Maori has always been a language rich in imagery, subtlety, and nuance, as are most languages. But those able to appreciate that level of language become fewer by the day. My hopes, however, are neither dashed nor totally diminished, as this new generation of fluent speaker aspires to and has a hunger for that command of language. In traditional society, there would have been the few with that level of language able to comprehend the use of metaphor, apothegm, simile, euphemism, hyperbole, broadening, and allusion, whether to song, to dance, or to legend, and in the present context, to the Bible, when the orators were in full flight. Oratory, a cultural imperative even today, was and still is a mark of a master of the language and the traditions of his people. Such individuals were and are held in high esteem and regard by their own tribe and by other tribes as their reputations spread. Once it was and is known that such and such an orator was and is about to rise to speak, people assembled to hear what he might have to say. In contemporary Maori society, such is still the case, as the reputation of orators of note precedes them, as does that of the not so notable, not so dynamic, but very soporific speaker. I made the following comment some years ago regarding the art of whaikōrero, oratory, which I still hold to be true, and I quote, "If one considers the marae, one will appreciate that by its very ethic and philosophy, competition is an integral part of the rituals of welcome. Only the most articulate, the most eloquent, and the most learned rise to speak. The response from the guests is in similar vein because the reputation of both host and guest depends to such a high degree on the quality of performance of all the participants." All tribes respond to the imperative with differing levels of success, depending upon the fluency of the speaker nominated by them to speak on their behalf. As the language becomes less and less spoken in some tribal areas, so the deterioration in oratorical skills accelerates. Hence my stating, quote, "What was once a noble and lofty art is fast degenerating into perfunctory, platitudinous recited litany of rote learned words and phrases. The occasions are becoming fewer when one could be moved and stirred by the command of rhetoric, of metaphor, of mythical allusion, of pithy and apposite aphorism, of wit and candor, of subtlety and nuance, interspersed with chant where appropriate, and concluded with haka. In most tribes, the oratorical benches, the paepae, are occupied by the elders, and it is accepted that they will perform the role essential to that office on behalf of the tribe. However, in some tribes, we now have a generation of elders who are not fluent speakers of Māori, but by dint of their age, still occupy the paepae despite their linguistic ineptitude and incompetence. There is a passive tolerance of the situation because of the cultural imperative of respect for age. But there is now a younger, more fluent, more informed generation able to acquit themselves well in the role of orator, thereby maintaining the reputation of the tribe. Without resorting to fisticuffs, it is a situation needing to be addressed, and the older generation needs to recognize the when and the where. They will always be needed to retain the dignity of the office and to dispense advice when necessary, for they have sat, heard, and observed over many years, and therefore have a wealth of experience to impart to the young, who must be prepared to listen and to take direction without umbrage if they are to represent their tribe well. There is a saying that the marae is cold without the presence of elders, so they will always have their place on the marae. You, the long-suffering audience, because of all the foregoing remarks, are no doubt coming to the rapid conclusion that this is nothing but an exercise in self-pity, despondency, and despair. Certainly, were I in your place, I would probably be of a similar conviction, given all the Sturm und Drang thus far. Let me hasten to reassure you that all is not that bad, or as my ancestors would have it, he iti hau marangai e tu te pā hoka hoka. Every cloud has a silver lining. There is a pop song which has the line, every generation blames the one before. And that has certainly been the case with us, the Māori. The finger pointing and casting of blame on previous generations, with the benefit of hindsight, needless to say, has provided the latter ones with the justification for their own lassitude, torpor, and apathy, and doing nothing about their own language command, but would rather sit and wring their hands in douleur, constantly demanding commiseration for their inertia. There are avenues available to all who would but commit, and who have the necessary drive and hunger to make it happen. Admittedly, prior generations of parents did abdicate their linguistic responsibility by opting to abandon their own language in favor of that which promised economic gain and a guaranteed livelihood. In so doing, they deprived future generations of a language and culture legacy to which they had every right, thus prompting the question asked in a contemporary Waiata Aringa, a song, Iaha tia e koe taku taonga, what have you done with my heritage? One of the tragedies of the Māori situation is that even the educated middle classes who were fluent speakers of Māori abandoned the transmission of the language to their children. They are the very people who, one would have thought, should have appreciated the value of language retention in terms of cultural identity and well-being, but that neglect added to the breakdown in intergenerational transmission, and essential for the survival of any language. Purely and simply, it is the reason the Māori language finds itself in the dilemma in which it now is. The punitive measures suffered by our parents and grandparents in the school system have been part of the mix in the non-transmission of the language, but in the light of a new day, they no longer offer sanctuary to those wishing to avoid the inevitable barbs from a new, far more demanding, discriminating, better educated and critical generation. It is the generation that wants it now and had it on a platter, but nothing worthwhile is achieved that way. Out of this generation of latter-day critics and fault finders has come a cohort who have risen above all the rhetoric. They are committed, dedicated, brook no compromise, and insist on linguistic standards. They are, in the main, second language learners who have come from non-Māori-speaking backgrounds, but through dint of their own commitment to the proposition that this language must be retained and must be spoken more widely, they have attained extremely high levels of fluency and command. Add to this number those who have come through the Kohanga Reo, Kura Kaupapa, Whare Kura Stream, these are all total immersion levels of schooling. We then have a formidable number of Mumurel language warriors. This is the group that will be the salvation of the Māori language. Te Panekiriatanga o Te Reo was founded specifically for people of this ilk, and while we have had many successes, we have had some who were not quite so successful. As an organisation, we have suffered the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune for being highly selective, elitist and arrogant, but we make no apologies for our stance on the level of language demanded and the standards insisted upon of those who enter our portals. We are present on our 9th intake, with the 10th intake scheduled to be selected later this year. If I have a concern with this generation of Māori speaker, and irony of all ironies, it is their command of English, even though in the main that is their principal language. The mentor, in exhorting his trainee warriors to reach the ultimate in the field of battle, advises them, Kia raka te mauwi, kia raka te katau. Be truly ambidextrous, with neither side inferior or superior to the other, but with both equally strong. We have taken and adapted this advice by saying to our students, be the ultimate and consummate bilingual, so that the command of both languages, Māori and English, are on a par. Previous generations of native speakers of Māori had an equally good command of English and could go from one language to the other with facility. That level of equal command is also wished of this generation, to be able to go from the idioms, colloquialisms and expressions of one language to the other with ease and yet maintain the essential ethos of either language when speaking it. The future survival of the Māori language rests with this generation. I have stated that the Māori language would never again be the principal language of the Māori world if the majority of the Māori world persists with the attitude of indifference to its own language. It will, however, be the chosen and preferred language of many of the Māori world because of its importance in our rites of passage, but more so because these are the ones who have manifested their love of the language by being its principal speakers, no matter where they are, giving credence to the saying, ko te reo kia tika, ko te reo kia rere, ko te reo kia Māori. The language must be correct, the language must be widespread, and the language must be Māori in ethos. As more and more of my generation of native speaker departs this mortal coil, it becomes ever more urgent for us to pass on what knowledge we have to those of succeeding generations who really care about the language and its survival into the millennia to come. It will not be an easy road to hoe, as the young speakers of today are but an oasis in a desert of cynics, ill-informed critics, the hypercritical, the ignorant, and the linguistically inept. In the way, however, of my generation, the question is posed, will this new generation be able to acquit themselves as well as we did? And will they treasure and appreciate what we bequeathed to them? An arrogance, considering previous generations were the architects of the language loss by not having spoken to their children, thus beginning the downward spiral to total loss if not arrested. An arrest has and is being made. The auguries for the future of the language are good, and its survival among the dedicated and the committed is assured. There will be gaps in their command because of their non-exposure to the language in some particular context, but is that not true of any language, whether healthy or moribund? Highly idiomatic and colloquial usage will be the deficit, but to artificially manufacture context so such terms can be employed is difficult for native speakers, but try we must, otherwise a crucial and colourful part of the language will be totally lost. This generation now needs to create its own idioms, its own ritualistic formulae, its own codes of etiquette and protocol, but be able to justify such compositions and innovations by providing a cultural base that is Māori in ethic and Māori in ethos. It is a generation of speakers who are very literate, articulate, and culturally deferential without being obsequious, yet not too reticent to express an opinion, should one be called for, whatever the issue under review. It is the generation of writers in the language, the lyricists for many of the haka teams who compete in the national arena every 2 years, the poets and the storytellers, as well as the critics. Theirs is a fresh point of view, couched in a language still traditional in style, and yet innovative on occasion, without sounding too alien to the native speaker's ear, which is the definitive and ultimate test. People enthusiastic about being fluent and literate in the language need support from a variety of sources, including institutions that provide quality exemplars of the language. One such source is Te Pukaria. Te Pukaria, the National Māori Language Institute based at AUT University, was first conceived around a conversation in 2005 with myself, Dr. Wharehiuia Milroy, and the two professors, Tania Ka'e and John Woofield. We wanted to establish an institute that reflects the work and vision of many Māori leaders who have worked tirelessly in the revitalisation of Te Reo Māori, the Māori language. The professors at the Ringaraupa, they're the calloused hands, the workers, for Wharehiuia and myself, worked on developing a proposal to establish the institute. With extensive consultation with institutions and organisations nationally, and with funding provided by the Tertiary Education Commission, Te Pukaria was established in July 2008. Te Pukaria is a strategic development as, one, it is the only research institute in Aotearoa New Zealand that is undertaking research on Te Reo Māori. Two, it builds capacity by supporting and employing postgraduate students who are focusing their research on aspects of Te Reo Māori or writing theses in Te Reo Māori. Three, it is committed to the dissemination of its resources and knowledge by making all resources free and accessible as possible. Four, it brings together experts on Māori language and tikanga, customary law. These people have considerable mana, that's a reputation within academia, and Māoridom. This gives Te Pukaria a mandate to research and publish independent of other academic institutions. Five, Te Pukaria is open to new organisations and communities in Aotearoa New Zealand to gain access to the resources they produce and receive. Six, the international community, including groups from Australia, the Pacific, and the Americas, recognises Te Pukaria's personnel, research, and resources in assisting the revitalisation and advancement of endangered languages globally. This interest has seen the establishment of Te Whare o Rongo Māori Kura, the International Centre for Language Revitalisation. To bring all this raving to some logical conclusion, let me ask this question on myself. Do I have any concerns regarding the retention of the Māori language? My response is a categorical no, because this dedicated, committed generation to whom I have made reference throughout this paper and to whom I raise my hat in salute will ensure that does not happen. Furthermore, they are the ones passing on the language to their children who, hopefully, will in their turn do the same to their children, and so intergenerational transmission will be resumed and therefore guaranteed. The words of Angiri state, E awia ma te kōrero tonu, ma te kōrero tonu, but by being constantly spoken, in response to a statement that all avenues are doomed to failure if the language is not spoken. Another Ngeri states, which is the one you heard at the beginning, whakahokia mai, whakahokia mai, mai te mata o te pene ki te mata o te arero. Kei noho kaunua, hei reo mo te pepa te pene. Restore it to its rightful position from the tip of the pen to the tip of the tongue, lest it be destined to be a language solely for pen and paper. When this quote was given somewhere else, I was told by one of the members of the audience, that you also need written literature, and I agree with that. I'm not sort of saying, but what we're saying is there needs to be a very strong combination of written and spoken language for the language to be healthy and survive. Used as the preface to this homily, it has other lines that present that this present generation of speakers will bring to life, not only in performance, but also in practice, because they seriously endorsed the sentiments expressed therein. The language ball is now in the court of the present generation. And in my heart of hearts, I know they will wrestle and will fight all battles necessary with no resiling on their part to realise the words of one of our best love songs composed by one of our most famous composers, the late Ngoipe Whairangi, who says quite simply, but no less strongly, hearken to the Māori language calling you. Hearken to the noble teachings gifted to us by the Almighty. So hold fast to your language and never stop speaking it. Take heed also of the sacred customs of our ancestors. Reach out for them as a salve for the soul. Then broadcast that fact far and wide, even unto the heavens. But never, never let the language languish and die. Rather, let it be given life once more by speakers yet unborn. Such is the message for the present and future generations. So, take heed. In the culture of my people, and in the culture of my people, no public utterance is complete without a song at the end of it. So these people are here to sort of fulfill that cultural requirement. And so they are going to sing the psalm that I've just given you the translation for.
You don't need.